So yeah, so I'm going to talk about Kotlin multi-platform right now, and I'm especially going to share code between iOS and Android. So as was said before, I'm going to specialize on that because that's what I do day to day. So I'm an Android developer, and usually on every project we have like some Android developers and some iOS developer. We're usually doing the same application, usually writing the same code. We usually have like to be sure that we pass our network object the same way. We have to make sure that we don't introduce the same bug. Maybe sometimes you got bug on iOS that you don't have on Android, and vice versa. It's usually a mess to debug. So what if there was a way to share code between iOS and Android? That would be nice, right? And so for that, I'm going to just explain what Kotlin multiplatform is. So first off, I'm going to address all of the other cross-platform technology that exists out there. So you've got a lot of stuff that already exists, so why would you introduce a new one? So there's usually React Native and Flutter that are the big one that everybody talks about and uses. So those technology, usually what you do is you write your app once, so you write it in React Native, write it in Flutter, and you're done. You've got your app that's ready to run in Android or ready to run in iOS. So that's kind of a really nice way to do. So you write once, you run anywhere. Kotlin multi-platform is completely different that way. So you don't actually run anything. You won't write your code in Kotlin multi-platform. You just use it to share some code. So it's not a framework that you use as the main, as your main coding platform. It's just a way to share code. So that's a big paradigm shift for that. So it's more similar to C++, where in C++ you would share code. There's a lot of companies that have actually used C++ to share code. Java to Objective-C is another example that has been used in Inbox. That's dead now, but that was the Gmail equivalent. So there is a quote from Kevin Gilligan. You might have not heard of him. He's somebody that's really pushing Kotlin multi-platform. So he's doing a lot of stuff to help Kotlin multi-platform out there. And the quote is that the shared UI is the history of pain and failure, but shared logic is the history of computers. So if you look at that with Java in mind, for example, that's a really good example. Java is a really famous language that exists, and the GVM is something that got really, really popular and really used over time. It started in the 1990s, that is still out there. But Java came out with some UI framework as well. Nobody uses that, and like you can talk about Swing, AWT. It exists, nobody uses it. Everybody uses it just to share code and to reuse code everywhere. We can talk about front-end framework as well that change every 2 years, 3 years. That's something that UI is something that's less stable, and usually you try to share code more than UI. So what is Kotlin multi-platform? So Kotlin is a language that was created for the GVM at the beginning. So what it does is that it creates, you write your code in Kotlin, and it's going to actually compile it into Java bytecode. So that Java bytecode is going to run on the JVM. So that's a dot class or a jar file that you get on the JVM. And Kotlin multi-platform is an initiative by JetBrains to add compilers so that you can compile your Kotlin code into JavaScript or into Kotlin native. So there was a big talk about Kotlin native that appeared. So that's usually the shortcut to talk about Kotlin multi-platform. Kotlin multi-platform is to talk about the fact that you can use it both on iOS, Android, JavaScript, on a lot of different platforms. Kotlin native is specific to iOS code and to native code. So Kotlin native is the compiler to compile on iOS. It works also on Linux, on macOS, and you could even compile into WebAssembly code. So as an example, if you get Kotlin code that you write, what you can do with that is that you can compile it and you get a command.jar or library.jar, and that's that jar file that you would use in a project afterwards. Same thing with the JavaScript compiler. When you compile it, you would get a JavaScript file. So that one is more of a transpiling thing than a compiling, but that's you would get a JavaScript file that you can use in your JavaScript project. And the one that we would use for iOS, that would be Kotlin native, so you would have your Kotlin code that would get compiled into a command.framework. A command.framework in iOS land it's the artifact that they use to share code and to have libraries. So it's basically a header, like a header file, a .h, with some compiled C code in there. And so you can access that in Objective-C and Swift. So the main thing in there is that you write Kotlin code. So you have to write Kotlin code, and that's pure Kotlin code, in the way that you don't have access to all of the platform code that you need. So the platform code is usually what you wouldn't think about, but Java is not accessible in Kotlin multiplatform, in Kotlin code, because Java is on the JVM only, and the native Kotlin native wouldn't know about those classes. So an example would be the java.time classes. You don't have access to that. And even the older one where java.util, where you would have all of the dates and calendar, you wouldn't have access to that. So what do you do if you don't have access to that? You can actually still reuse some code from the platform. So you could, the code from the platform that you would use, you can use different methodology to get access to that. So there is the main one that is the most easy to think about. It's a regular interface implementation. So that's the way that you actually write code in your day-to-day work. So you would write an interface that's in your Kotlin common code. That's the interface that you would use everywhere in your code. So for example, if I need to store some data, I would create an interface for storage. I would have a store my data and a get my data method in there, in that interface. And I would need to have an implementation in both iOS and Android, as they would be my platform to use. There is another mechanism that's been introduced by Kotlin multiplatform, which is expect actual. So this one is almost the same as an interface. You say that you expect the classes and you have an actual implementation. The big difference is that it's compiled, so the implementation has to be there, otherwise it doesn't compile. So all of the targets that you create, you have to have an actual implementation for that. The interface one, the developer that uses your library, that just implement it. You don't have to provide the implementation. But with expect actual, you do. So good thing is that right now we've got some way to use the platform code and we can write our Kotlin code, but a good platform is usually worth the community. The community is making it better. And there's actually a lot of libraries that are already created for that, and you usually don't have to go and to create your own interfaces and create your own implementation. You can just write code and use some libraries, and they're already there, and you're going to be fine using that. So in there we've got Kator, that's the most famous one. It's going to take care of doing all of your network and your networking. So that's compatible with all of the platform from Kotlin multiplatform. So you can compile JS, you can use it in JavaScript, you can use it in native code, and you can use it on the JVM. And Kator is going to be the one that for you is actually choosing which implementation it uses. So it's got an HTTP client implementation for all of the platform. Kotlin Xserialization is the new parsing library out there. So it's the equivalent of Mochi or JSON that you would get in Android. OKIO is the one for five. So that's part of the libraries that were written in Kotlin at some point, and they made the effort to make it multi-platform. And SQL Delight is a way to get your database working on both iOS, Android, and Java. Probably JavaScript, I'm not sure. Okay, so once we know what Kotlin multiplatform does, how can we apply it to our use case that would be mobile application, iOS and Android? So here I tried to put like a simplified architecture of an app. Obviously, you probably have way more classes in your applications, there are way more layers probably, maybe. But if we try to strip it down and to put it as simple as possible, almost, we would get usually the UI, that's the views. That's the one that's really close to the platform because you need to know which platform you're on to display your view. You'd have the view models, the business logic, the network, and the storage. But in there, what you can see is that it's basically the same between Android and iOS. Even if the implementation that you actually use of that architecture might be different, they use Viper or coordinators or like different patterns on iOS, but it kind of it's kind of the same in the end, and the separation is really similar. So what would Kotlin multi-platform bring into that? It would allow you to have some shared code in there. So you could have imagine to have a library that's just written in Kotlin multi-platform, so that would store all of the business logic, do your network call, store your data, and that one would be written only once in Kotlin, in a Kotlin multi-platform library. And then your iOS app and your Android app would use that one. So that part would mean that your code would be the same, so you know that you're going to have the same bugs on both apps, on that business logic, and you know that everything is going to be the same. So it's consistent, it's only one code to maintain, and it might help on velocity. It's not really, it might not be like a divided by two in time, but it's still like only one base code to share, to use. And you usually would have probably more time than in that case to write iOS specific code or Android specific code, which always take a lot of time. If you want to really polish your app and do a lot of Android specific implementation in there, you would have more time for that probably. So in there, I put my view model in the platform specific implementation. That was a choice just for simplicity. One of the nice things with Kotlin multi-platform is that you can actually choose what you want to share. So it's your choice as a developer and as a team to choose where you want to put the cursor of sharing. So if you want to share more, you can. If you want to share less, you can as well. You can just decide, if I want to share my business logic, I'll share my business logic. If I want to share my view model, I'll share my view models. So it might make sense for applications that are view models that are really generic to share them. But however, if you have like a view model that's really tightly coupled to your view, and you have different views between your platforms, you might not want to share them. If your team has more iOS developers, you probably want to still have more iOS code, so you will have view models in iOS. And same for the use case, if the screens are completely different, you're probably not going to share your view models. It's going to depend on every single case, but it's mostly on you to decide that. Okay, so once we've got the view of what Kotlin multi-platform is, I've created a sample and I've played around a little with it, so I'm just going to show some code to get a concrete view of what it is. So first, in my sample, what I'm going to do is to have like all of the code in the same repo. So that's a choice that you can do. You can still have a different repository for iOS, a repository for Android, and just then share via library. But for simplicity, I just put everything in the same repository, in the same folder. The thing is, there's still three projects in there. I still got an Android project that would be run with Android Studio and as a build.gradle, that's the main building blocks of the project. And I still have an iOS project that will open the Xcode, and that's really like a Swift project that's written using all of the native iOS development tools. So you would open it here in Xcode and just change stuff in Xcode in there. But on top of that, you've got the common module. That's this one would be written in pure Kotlin code, and you can have everything that you want to share in there. So the way to do that, you have to configure your common module in Kotlin. So the Kotlin multi-platform uses Gradle to build. That's the main build system used for Kotlin projects. And it's as simple, it's applying a plugin in your module. So instead of applying the Kotlin Android module plugin that you usually apply, you would apply the Kotlin multi-platform module plugin, sorry. And in there, what you have to do is in the Kotlin tag, you would have to declare which target you wanna use. So in there, I declare that I want to use the JVM for Android, and that I want to use the iOS for iOS application. But it's in there that you could say I wanna have JavaScript as well. So you could add JavaScript, or you could add or something else than iOS, so that would be macOS or Linux or WebAssembly. And then like a regular Gradle project, you would add dependencies in there. and you can choose which dependency to put. So once I've got my common module created, I need to use it in my Android project. So the way that I use it in Android would be via Gradle, since we're already using Gradle in Android code. So to do that, I would just, as simple as using a module like we talked in the morning, we can just add the common project in there. And so it's gonna be usable directly. So everything that you wrote in your Kotlin common module is gonna be usable in that Android project now, because you just add it as a dependency. And since it's a jar, as we said at the beginning, it's just gonna work right away. For iOS, it's a little bit more complex, but it's still kind of straightforward. So on iOS, they use a dependency management system that's called CocoaPods. That's not the only one they use, but that's the one that's compatible with Kotlin. So you would have to declare your common module as a CocoaPod. So you use a plugin for that, Sam. So you would apply the plugin, give it the information that it needs. So that's just versioning and description. And once you've got that done, you can actually use it as well in the iOS project. So that means adding it as a pod in the actual iOS project. So that file is empty for now and only has the my pod file in there, but usually for normal iOS project, you would have a list of all of the pods that they use, same than in our Gradle file where you would have like networking and all of that, and you can just add it in there as if it was a library, an actual iOS library. As an example of code, just to show that's a data class that you would do normally in Kotlin, so you can just do that. That class then is going to be usable right away in Swift and Android once you import it. So that's the kind of the magic of it. If when you're in Swift, you can still access mymovie.id or mymovie.description. It's going to work as if it was a Swift object. It's actually a Swift object. And same in Android, obviously, you can use it in Kotlin as normal. So now let's imagine that I've got a movie repository. I don't have time to show that one because it's a bit more complex. But I just a movie repository that would just try to get movie out of the network. If I want to use it in Android, I would just need to create my repository. So I could use Dagger or Independency Extension or Coin or anything to create it. Once I've got my repository, I can just use it like that right away. I just call it. So in here, it's using coroutines. So I need to launch a coroutine. But once I've got my list of movie, I just can use it like normal. So that's the easy part because that's in Android. But in iOS, it's basically the same. It's really easy as well. So that's Swift code. It really looks like Kotlin, but that's Swift. They're really similar. And so you would create your repository and your service and then use it in there. So there is a small gotcha on there because the coroutines are not completely supported. I'll go into more details afterwards, but you have to have a small hack to use it. So instead of having to launch a coroutine, which doesn't exist in Swift, you have to go through a callback. So it's a little different, but you can just, it works. You can use it like that. Okay, so that was like really, really small sample of code. The main thing over there is like to talk about drawbacks and advantages. There is some drawbacks, quite a lot as well. I talked quickly about the Gradle configuration before. So it's still really, really, it's still young. Because right now, when you want to configure your Gradle project, if you start from zero, it takes a lot of time. You get a lot of errors. You have to debug them. It's painful. You've got to do a lot of stuff. You have to understand how it works. Gradle by default, even on Android, can be hard to use sometimes. And in here, it can be even more difficult. So that's something where you probably should like get a project that works already and copy that one and do some tweaks in there, but it's really hard to set up if you want to start from zero and understand what's going on. It's kind of hard. Same thing for dependencies. Adding dependencies can be a hard task because you have to add dependency for your Kotlin code, but most of the time you have to add dependencies for all of the platform as well. So if you have if you add Ktor as a dependency, you have to add Ktor iOS as an iOS dependency, then Ktor Android as an Android dependencies, and you kind of never know which one you have to add and which one you don't. So it's kind of it gets quite complex, and the documentation of those libraries is not always up to date and the best. So it can be hard. The second big one that I kind of mentioned, I don't want to go into too much details in there because that's a really, really hard subject. Coroutines are not supported right now in iOS. So in your Kotlin code, you would use coroutines almost everywhere. Ktor is actually using coroutines really heavily, and it's the main networking library that you can use. But that's not supported on iOS, so you have to go with some hacks, the one that I've shown. So it's still not ready for that. Like once coroutine is going to be in there, it's going to makes everything really, really much easier. And multi-threading as part of that. So if you want to change threads, it might get hard because you have to, on native, on iOS code, you have to handle yourself the memory allocation. Well, you don't have to, but they do it like under the hood. And if you want to actually create different threads, you have to freeze your objects to be sure that it can actually be used on another thread. That gets hard as well. But that's something that usually you don't have to do. You don't have to do yourself. It's done by you. It's done for you. So I talked a lot about Ktor. That's one of the new libraries. So that's a new library to learn. That's something that we don't know. You don't know yet as a developer usually. So you would have to learn Ktor. You would have to learn all of the tools that you need to use on multi-platform. It can be daunting at the beginning because it's completely new stuff. And some of them actually like Kotlin X serialization, that's still pretty new. It's still missing some of the features that you're using when you're using Mochi, for example, or JSON even. It's still new, so they're working on it a lot, but it's still new for that, and it can be a big task to actually learn those libraries and to use them and try to find a way to do what you are doing in Android, in normal Android libraries, into those new libraries. And the last drawback, that might be one of the bigger ones. The other ones are more related to the fact that Kotlin multi-platform is kind of new. So the fact that there's new libraries to learn is because those libraries are new. The fact that coroutine is not supported, it will be in the future, they're working on that. But the fact that your team might not want to use Kotlin multi-platform is probably a big one, especially on iOS side. So it's going to be hard to convince iOS developer to use Kotlin multi-platform, especially since they're going to, a part of their app is going to be written in Kotlin. It's going to feel like they're losing the ownership over that code probably. So that means that they're going to have to learn Kotlin to be still the owners of that project, which is probably one of the hard thing to do. I think for the better of the overall project, it's probably nicer, but it's going to be still like more work for them to come over and to be willing to do that. Because for Android developer, it's going to be just doing another module instead of just one. But yeah, that's easier for Android developer. And as part of that, it also adds some kind of complexity, and you kind of have to do some kind of small mental shift. So you have to think about more libraries and how I can share code, which code should I share, and it requires you to think about it. So it's just like one more thing to think about. So that's some drawbacks, but there's advantages, actually a lot of them as well. So one of the big advantages, especially compared to other cross-platform solutions, there is no notion of bridges where you have to bridge between a language, which would be JavaScript or Dart, to your language, which is Swift or Java. And there's none of that, because you actually, in the end, you're actually using the platform that you're meant to use. So you're still using all of the Android API, so you can use them. There's no problem to use them. You can use all of the iOS tools as well, the iOS libraries. So you can do your UI in Jetpack Compose when Jetpack Compose is going to be there. You can do it in Swift UI right now if you want to. It's really, there's no problem using the the phone capacity and the actual the sensor as well, that there is no issue using the camera. You can use camera X in Android and that's fine. It's just and one of the really, really good advantages as well is that it's really low commitment. So since you're sharing code, you can actually choose which code you want to share. So you can choose to share everything if you want to, but if you want to test it and just like try to see if it works, you can just choose, I'm going to try that feature, I'm going to try Kotlin multi-platform on that feature, and that's it. So you can put it in a really small part of your app. It's going to be only there. You can try it out, see if it works. If it doesn't, what's the worst that can happen? You just have to write it in iOS code because it's basically Kotlin. It's already there for Android. So it's really easy to remove if you want to. And it doesn't lock you in at all because you'd write your application as if you're writing a normal Android application or normal iOS application. You don't start that all, I'm going all in React Native, or I'm going all in Flutter. It's just a normal project where you're adding like one small part in Kotlin multi-platform. So I was talking before about the mental shifts. You have to change the way you code, but it's also an advantage, in my opinion at least. It forces you to think about your architecture and what you're going to do. So if you want to share code, you have to have a clean separation of concern. So you're not going to be able to use Android classes in your networking layer, which is, in my opinion, a good thing. It's easier to test. It makes sure that there is less probably bugs from Android that are in there. And you can just like the networking does what it's supposed to do, and it doesn't need to know about a context. That's just like something that doesn't need to be there. One big advantages, of course, is that you're using Kotlin. So Kotlin is an amazing language, and so you use it for that as well. You don't have to learn something else. You use it right away, and so that's the skills that you already have, you can reuse them for that. It doesn't have to be a new language like JavaScript or Dart. And for that, it's actually also easier for your iOS developers, because as Swift is really, really close to Kotlin, it's really the same way to code. So they're gonna have to learn it, but it's gonna be more easy for them to learn Kotlin than it is to learn something else, because it's almost the same. It's really, when you code in Kotlin, you code in the same way that you code in Swift, and vice versa. So you kind of already know how to use the language, you just don't know the constructs. So you have to learn the keywords and the way specific thing works, but it's still the same mindset. I'm the only one talking about that in here today, but there's a lot of conference everywhere. A lot of them are talking about Kotlin multi-platform. There's a lot of traction. JetBrains is working actively on it. There's a lot of new work doing on that. They're really going pretty fast. I've tried it 8 months ago, I think. Since then, they did a new version, and there is actually CocoaPods, the one that I put in there was added afterwards. It makes it way more easy with that. They're still working on it. They're gonna probably release a new version with Coroutine soonish, I hope. There's traction over there. There's actually Square, that's a really big company that have done a lot of open source for Android, that's putting a lot of work into Kotlin multi-platform. Their library are usually but they've started to convert some of their library into Kotlin, and at the same time they're making it work on multi-platform. So SQL Delight is an example of Square starting a library for a database. They moved it into multi-platform. They've done it with OK.io. Maybe at some point they might do it for OKHTTP, just like they're pushing for Kotlin multi-platform over there. And they're probably using it internally, but that's the thing we don't really know. And there's also a lot of them doing conferences. So there's KotlinConf that's happening in a month. There's going to be a lot of Kotlin multi-platform talks over there. So after all of the advantages and drawbacks, the big question that's going to be, should we use it? And should we put it in our production app? For now, with the coroutines and the really painful configuration, it's still not completely ready. It's still really in an early stage. But the good thing is, what I was saying before, you can actually try it and you can make your own opinion about it. And since it's moving quite fast, it's in beta, it's not going to change that much. So if you like it and that you want to use it on small feature, you can definitely use it. It works. It's just more setup, and you've got to do the small hacks for the coroutines, but you can make it work and it's going to be completely fine. It's not going to be full of bugs. But it's still something that's going to take some time to set up. So you kind of have to have more experience, I think, because if you start from zero and start learning Kotlin multi-platform right away when you don't even know Android or iOS, it's going to be hard, because you kind of have to know the platform before you can try to do and to share code like that. That's basically it for me. I've got more details in there, so I've got a small sample on my GitHub. There's the DroidCon New York City app. That's a really good example. They've done it in Kotlin multi-platform, so they're actually storing all of the sessions in a database, so you can see how to interact with the database in Kotlin multi-platform. And there's the Kotlin Conf in a month. So check that out, because there's going to be a lot of content. And yeah, thank you.